Keith Wood, good morning to you. How are you?
Good morning. I'm great, thank you. How are you, Ger?
I'm very excited, Keith. The Six Nations is upon us. We have usual, I don't want to swear at this hour of the morning, but the usual Eddie Jones stuff going on. We have a very exciting Ireland setup where almost everybody who you want is fully fit and available for injuries. But before we get into our preview of the Six Nations, I think it's important that we mark something here. Do we have a little bit of a song? A little bit of Stevie Wonder. You're about the same age as Stevie Wonder, aren't you, Keith?
I'm officially about the same age at this stage, yeah.
Well, look, we are not quite the same age, Keith, but we certainly, Eamon Andrews is a cultural icon in our lives, and we're going to get to do a little bit of Eamon Andrews right now, because Keith Wood, this is your broadcasting life. Could I say good morning to John Inverdale? John Inverdale, good morning to you. Well,
Morning, Woody. Happy birthday.
To Jeremy Guscott. Jeremy Guscott, good morning to you.
Good morning, Jer. Happy birthday, Woody.
And to Jonathan Davis.
Oh, baby.
Good morning.
Hi, Woody, boy. Hi, Woody. I can't believe you're only 50, mate.
You and me, I tell you what.
That's a proper surprise, I have to say.
Almost speechless, Keith. It's never happened before.
No, and actually speechless isn't great for the radio either, mind you.
John, if I might be so bold as to start with you, American comedy has the great tradition of the roast, so if there's any good stories about Keith Wood that you would like to tell us at this particular moment, feel free, have at it.
I haven't got a great story other than to say, everybody listening to this won't be surprised to hear me say this, but the first time that I walked around the streets of Dublin with Woody, I felt like I could have been walking around Rome with the Pope or Moscow with Putin. I mean, it was just extraordinary. The reverence that he was held in. And this little bald chap was just walking around the streets, just waving to his people. And I thought, my God, what an extraordinary power to have, but also just conducted in with such amazing class and dignity. And I suspect I'm speaking on behalf of Jerry and Jeffy here to say that just a real thrill to have been able to experience that and to have learned so much about Ireland, actually, through Woody as well. And if I throw a serious thing in here, if people will remember the first time England played at Croke Park and there were so many elements, politically sensitive elements about that. And to have Keith as a very wise owl guiding me and guiding all of us actually through that was very important, but also very, very, very educational as well.
Yeah, you guys had the best part of 15 years together, I suspect, for the Six Nations through the ups and downs of some brilliant matches and some particular brilliant eras for, I think, basically every country had a little period of at-bat where we were good over those years, which I think probably helped to cement the fact that you were a collection of equals, Jeremy, in many ways.
I think England probably had the poor share of that time, even though they got to a World Cup final in 2007. I always used to have conversations with Woody that Ireland were much better than our discussions. Well, Keith was always kind of underplaying Ireland, and I was always kind of bigging them up, thinking they should be winning championships and Grand Slams. So that was always a good debate that I had with Woody. And John Invers was there talking about, you know, some stories about Woody. My stories always involve a little bit of drinking. And I'm pretty much lucky to be alive, because I remember spilling some red wine over Woody, over a white shirt, and how I survived that. Well, I kind of know, because we're both as locked as each other. And I think Woody kind of forgot about it in the end. The more we drank, the more it kind of soaked in and I got away with it. But some lovely days with Mr. Wood that I look back on fondly. And I look forward to many more, just maybe on the golf course and in restaurants.
He gets the old red wine lips. That's the other thing that I think people don't know about Keith Wood.
Yeah. He loves his wine.
He does like it. He does like his red wine. The only thing he does, every time I used to meet him, I used to cringe because he used to try and squeeze my hand when you shook it all the time, which I didn't like to tell him, but I could tell him now because I'm not with him. I was very childish, Keith, to be honest. You need to grow up sometimes. Maybe 50. 50 is the time now. But I do miss being together. We had a good laugh, and maybe on the Saturday, you know, it was work. but we really enjoy catching up on the Friday night and have a good meal and a good couple of drinks together, which maybe affected the show a little sometimes on the Saturday. But hey-ho, we were amateur.
I can't remember the name of the pub next door to Drury's in Dublin, but just on the corner there. And I remember lots and lots of nights in there, but one night in particular where for some reason a sing-song began and just carried on and carried on. And it was 10:30, then it was 11, then it was 11:30, then it was 12. And, you know, licensing laws, what licensing laws? And the landlord thought, I can't tell Keith Wood to stop singing. So we just carried on. And I did expect at about 1 o'clock that the landlord was going to say, here are the keys to the pub. Just leave when you feel like, just lock up and stick them through the letterbox, you know. Just fantastic evenings like that.
Keith, they were good times. You guys really enjoyed each other's company, and that chemistry actually came across genuinely on the screen as well.
They were great times. I mean, I don't take compliments very well, and I'm entertained by some of that. So I'm going to react to some of it if I can. But I will, I will say that when you hang up your boots from playing. So I retired 19 years ago, and it's a huge gap. There's an unbelievable gap, and I was very fortunate that I went straight into a team of the BBC. And that just made it incredibly different, incredibly comforting. I think it was like a halfway house away from retirement from sports. So that made it really good. I loved the way the BBC did things in those days in particular. And John's story about the game in Croke Park. 9 months before that game, the BBC asked me, look, Woody, we need to get this right. Do you know everything about that day in Croke Park? And I'd said, look, I know a lot of it, but I'm going to have to go and study it. And John and I presented a piece on it, and it was very interesting trying to get to that particular point. But on the wine with Jerry, I have to compliment him, because I know it wasn't him, it was his magnificent wife Saz, who sent me a bottle of wine this morning from Mike O'Meara, the wine
pub. That's me. I chose the wine. Staz might have sent it, but I definitely chose it.
But who paid for it?
Yeah, that'd be me.
I'd say Staz probably paid for it too, actually, yeah. But they were great days. I mean, I just loved the crack that we had with it. And you'd hope that it would come across, but every now and then the BBC would put a secret camera on when we were inside in the studio, and you'd get our reactions, and you'd forget the camera was there because you're off air at that moment when the game is on. And of course, we're total idiots, and you just get as excited as everybody else because you're not on the field anymore, but it's probably the next best thing.
Yeah, Jonathan, one of the things that I always found really interesting was just how popular those games were on the BBC and the viewership figures they did for a sport which was kind of still getting and coming to terms with the fact that it was professional. So you guys you were there to crest that wave where it has this crossover from the amateur era to the professional, and you kind of had to apply the professional rigor while still trying to maintain the things that made the game great as an amateur. From your own perspective, that must have been pretty interesting, given your own unique scenario where you played both professional and amateur.
Yeah, that was great. You know, I think keeping the amateur ethos about the game is very, very important. But no, yeah, you know, obviously, you know, it went professional, and it was very difficult. And if I look at it, maybe, you know, England, Scotland, and Ireland have done it a lot easier than Wales, because we had this kind of historical club tradition, and now it's turned into regions, and I don't think we've come to terms with it yet. But yeah, we certainly enjoyed that transition. I think we had a great balance, you know, in the studio and the commentators. We had a forward and a back usually in commentating or in studio, and the people that I was there a lot before, you know, Jerry and Woody, because I'm a lot older. I was very fortunate. I played against Jerry, but I unfortunately didn't play against Woody. But you know, having been there from kind of the start with John, seeing the caliber of people that the BBC picked, it was a pleasure, you know, to work with all these people, not only of their kind of intellect about the rugby game, but also, you know, the personalities that they had. And I thought, and I think, when you look at rugby clubs, especially in the professional era, when you sign a player, yes, okay, you sign him because of his qualities on the field, but also it's vitally important that the culture, that he fits into that culture, you know, off the field as well, and kind of buys into the the whole amateur ethos and the whole kind of integrity of that club. And I think that's what we were lucky to do and replicate. And, you know, we saw England go well, win Grand Slams. You know, then later on we saw Wales. And then we saw Ireland, to see Ireland, you know, win the Grand Slam in Cardiff was absolutely unbelievable. So, yeah, we've had some great times. I've sat there disappointed sometimes by the way things have turned out, but so have all of us.
It's an interesting point that Jonathan makes, Jeremy, where he talks about the balance and the need for it. You know, you guys very flamboyant and gifted backs, and Keith was a forward. It was important that maybe somebody was there.
He thought he was a back. He thought he was a back. Don't you worry. The side step in Wembley against Scott Gibbs. He always talks about that. Don't talk about it again.
He's never brought it up once.
Woody understood his place, to be fair. You know, Jonathan would say what he said, and then I'd get a bit, and then Woody would find a way. But, you know, being as bright and as intelligent as he is, he managed to barge us out of the way and get his say. I think it's, you know, as Jiffy said, we respected one another, and we'd all have a good point to make. And the good thing about it is that the banter that you had as a rugby player in a rugby team, in a change of room against opposition, a bit of sledging, you'd get that in the studio. Okay, a lot of it would be off camera, but then we'd have the red button where we'd all relax. And there was a little jib in a little, you know, if Ireland had played well, you know, would he be a bit like a peacock, as I would if England had won, and Jiffy with Wales. So the great side of it was we had the crack in the studio, and we really did get stuck into each other, sometimes off air, but definitely on air as well, which was good. You got to have that.
Yeah, exactly. And John, I suppose from your perspective, the challenge is to make sure that you get enough of that out so everybody gets to see at home what's happening, but not too much so that the complaints are being read out on whatever your version of mailbag is.
Well, I think one of the key things, we were quite lucky in many ways that our, if it was a golden era, our golden era with Woody 15 years or so, almost predated the explosion of social media. And so we were, if I say offend, I don't mean offend, because people could be offended by anything, but we were, if people said things that were controversial with a small C or a capital C, they could actually say it without fear of their phone instantly exploding and 83,000 people saying you're a complete this, that and the other. Because we were always accused. You know, Jonathan's always been accused of being manically pro-Welsh. And Woody was, you know...
That's because he is.
I spent the last 25 years of my life defending him for saying he's rational, impartial, and has a very clear view of the game. And I've said the same for everybody else. But, you know, it doesn't matter. If you want to hear bias and partiality in comments, you will hear it. He will hear it, irrespective of what anybody says. Yeah. So you have to just try and kind of ride that horse, you know.
But how did you get the crack out? Because you knew the chemistry between them. How did you make sure that you weren't a wet blanket on that? Because you obviously wanted to come out.
Yeah, but I thought my great belief all the while was never to script anything. Because we never had auto-cue for a start-off, which I think is a very important thing too. If you never have auto-cue and you actually don't have a script, then actually it allows people to be much more free-flowing and free-thinking than if they're having to adhere to a piece of paper or a screen that's telling them where to go next. And that does mean sometimes, obviously, that the timings... I mean, I'm listening to this programme this morning. What is it now? It's 8:27. This chat between us will finish at some point, whenever that might be. It might be half past, it might be 25 to 9, it might be whenever it is. But actually, that's what makes it better radio, because it's not scripted and it's not, you know, preordained what's going to happen. And I think that was the great thing that we were able to do.
Yeah. I think Jerry said that, you know, we all respect each other. And I was okay. And the good thing was, you know, we all always disagreed, really. But on television, people love to see that. People think, oh, you know, you were arguing with the sword. No, it wasn't an argument. We disagreed on a point that was made, maybe a refereeing decision or, you know, a certain incident or the style of play. But then, you know, the viewers loved that. And then we just got on with it. And then everyone thought, are you all okay? Yeah, we're okay. We just disagreed or something. We're going for a pint now. So that was a good thing. People loved that on television.
It's real. That's the thing. It's you're allowed to have disagreements with your mates. That's because that's how conversations actually happen around sport.
Yeah, yes.
Keith, do you miss it?
Is Keith still there?
Yeah. No, he's stunned to silence. Yeah.
He's crying. He's got his tissues out. Boy's drinking the red wine, one of the two.
Well, I would have always said, do I miss it? There's elements of it I really do miss, but I wanted to touch on one point. We're all fans, so I'm Irish. I'm rooting for Ireland. So people say, well, you need to be fully neutral. I struggled always with that idea because I want Ireland to win. And Jiffy wants Wales to win. Jerry wants England to win. And but that idea of us being professional about how we talk about it is different. So you watch the game with an analytical eye as what actually happened rather than what you wished happened, which is what most fans do a lot of the time, you know. So, but I do miss it. I thought it was the right time for me to stop when I did. I'd been doing it a long time. And I want to get on with my business life then after it. And it's always kind of nice to be able to say you're going to stop. And that was a nice thing too. But that was the last time I was properly cut off the hop when Invers and Jerry presented me with a cap for 21 years at the BBC, which was a long time.
Yeah, great stuff.
Still waiting for me.
In the post.
Yeah, okay, thank you.
It's coming. Before I ask you about the actual Six Nations and what might happen, if anybody has any other stories related to Keith Wood being a diva, now is the time, gentlemen, and this will definitely be clipped up and put on social media, so... okay, everybody's...
He's
a very sensible guy.
Sensitive? Is that what you said? Your line broke up a little bit there.
He's a very sensible lad, Keith.
So it's good to have Woody as your friend.
This is true. He is a diva when we're travelling. I mean, I've only travelled with him once or twice, but certainly the Vulcan death grip that you described a little bit earlier on.
Oh, yeah, that's the one.
That still exists and obviously inspired by his love of Star Trek too, but he's a complete diva when he's travelling. I mean, I just want to put that out there, Keith. So I presume...
Well, expect the best, isn't it?
Well, there you go. And you always be disappointed. Right, very quickly... this is a very interesting Six Nations. We're on the brink of the planning for the World Cup. Eddie Jones is missing some of his best and most important players. And Jeremy Guscott, I put it to you that that's not actually the worst scenario 18 months out from a World Cup, because you're forced to give other younger players the opportunity to step up, and you're forced to make other players become leaders.
Yeah, I guess. But I don't think people like being forced to do anything. You'd much rather have your best team at the time that you want. 18 months out, it's not the end, but I would rather have a kind of settled side now than not. But I think with Farrell, the captain, being injured, we've got a decent replacement, it seems, with Laws, who did very well in the autumn. And I think Marcus Smith just needs a really good run at 10. There's only probably around 20 games to the World Cup. He needs all the experience he can, and for him to govern that position, he needs the time. Eddie's on about picking Farrell at 12 just to guide him. I'm not sure if he needs that guidance. To me, it looks like he's got his head. He's very good tactically, and I think more often than not, England need to get that centre partnership shored up and given that and run of time. So I'll be interested to see who plays there. Slade had a good autumn. Marchant moved in from the wing to centre against South Africa. So that might be a starting midfield that looks good. As inexperienced as it is, I think it's certainly a threat in attack. So I wouldn't mind seeing that.
And one of the things about the injuries is that we somehow assume that England are less likely to win the competition. But actually, with Marcus Smith, there's a possibility that this team explodes into life here.
Oh, I don't take the glare too much away from Ireland and France. You know, the way those two sides played against New Zealand puts them, you know, as favourites to win the Six Nations. And if England come under the radar, which is pretty difficult, maybe they might relax and play some rugby. I mean, I want to see them attack. They've been fairly flat and boring for my liking. So the more youngsters you get in there, the more inexperienced, they might just go out there and attack. And I'd much prefer to see that than a kick chase defence. So England, please let it go.
Jonathan, pre-tournament last year, there was concerns around Wales and PVAC and all that kind of stuff, and then suddenly they burst into life over the course of the Six Nations, and we know he's going to be the coach now for the medium term anyway, all the way through to the World Cup. So what's the truth about where they are at the moment?
We all are the same. We don't do well in the autumn. Our regions are really struggling, you know, in the URC and in Europe. But for some reason, we turn up and perform in the Six Nations. And but I think this year, I think it'll be the toughest one yet. But as Jerry touched on, I thought Ireland and France were superb, especially in their wins against New Zealand. And, you know, Ireland could have beaten New Zealand by 30 clear points. I think just the fact that New Zealand is so good working on scraps that they came back into it. So we've got a lot of injuries. I don't think there's a lot of people coming through. So this season could be a real watershed moment for Welsh rugby, because if we lose badly and come, I think we'll come fifth this year. And if that does happen, people will realise that, you know, we're paving over the cracks in Wales. And, you know, it's time to look at what's happening with development of the game in Wales. We need creativity in midfield. We haven't got it. You know, if you look at England, France and Ireland, they develop players. And, you know, I always say that if you've got competition for places at that level, it doesn't breed complacency. And I think we haven't had a full-back in Wales for the last 10 years, apart from Liam Williams and Lee Halfpenny, nobody coming through. We haven't got a centre, you know, who's a footballing centre, creative centre, who can kick a ball. So it's, yeah, it's a bit worrying at this part, especially, you know, with they're going to Ireland first, and Scotland get a result against England, which they're capable of. Then, you know, we're going to Twickenham to, you know, and France then to come again. So it's going to be, I think it's going to be a real tough season for Wales. But one, I hope that they will try and create an attack and get the ball to our back three, because they're very dangerous. But I'm just looking forward to the whole Six Nations, because I think it's going to be very competitive with Ireland, England and France, you know, up there. But Scotland have improved dramatically, and how they, you know, how they didn't win last year's championship by beating France and England away, you know, is ridiculous. But yeah, really, really looking forward to this this tournament. And coming to Ireland, I'm coming to Ireland on the Friday night, so we'll see what happens there as well. That could be an interesting night before the Six Nations.
I'm sure there'll be
as it usually is,
a sing song somewhere. And I know you've got to go really soon, but John, can I ask your opinion? Who's going to win the Six Nations?
Yeah, well, I mean, all I would say, I mean, Jonathan painted a very sort of melancholy position of Wales there at the moment. I do think, you know, a lot of people who I work with and whatever say, oh, England, if when England smash Wales, that's great. It's actually, it's not great. It's not great for the competition. It's not great for the sport. And I hope that game at Twickenham is not as one-sided as a lot of people that I talk to at the moment think it's going to be, because I think a strong Wales makes a strong Six Nations, because they in many ways are often the heartbeat of the whole competition. My instinct is that England-Ireland at Twickenham is going to be the deciding match.
Right. Well, that would be something very much to look forward to. Although the final game, as we've already talked about on the show this morning, is actually England against France. And so there should be plenty riding on that. Well, gentlemen, the three of you, thank you so much for the surprise party. This is your life, Keith Woods.
Thank you,
gents.
Yeah, cheers, Jiffy. Cheers, Inverse. Thanks, Jerry. Great to talk to you.
Have a good one.
Great to see you virtually.
Cheers.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday,
man. How are you feeling, Keith?
Yeah, that's a good surprise. I like that now. I'd loads of notes for what you might have possibly asked me about this morning. That wasn't part of it. But yeah, it's great. I mean, we had such great crack over the years with the lads on and off air. And that sense of getting together, actually, I do miss. And strangely, COVID has delayed those sort of reunions that you get to meet up with the people. So we're going to rectify that this year as things move on.
Well, look, we wish you a very happy birthday. I don't know if there's anything specifically you want to say about the Six Nations. We have, like, the whole duration of the tournament speak about it, but
We have, and we'll talk about it plenty, I think, Chair. But no, that was lovely, really lovely.
Well, enjoy your birthday, and enjoy all the kind messages. We've got loads of lovely messages coming in here. We're going to read them out in a moment. If you want to stay on the line, you're going to hear a little montage that we put together, but we'll certainly send it to you a little bit later if you don't. But this is to celebrate Keith Wood's 50th birthday.
One of the elements of the journey, and every part of sport is a journey, life too, mind you, but is you have to enjoy and celebrate the successes along the way. Mm. If you just say, yeah, that's it, let's push it aside, let's not enjoy that, I think you're missing out on some of it. And I do feel for us, you're dead right, we should lose the run of ourselves.
Already in this game for the three quarters, for the sprinters. This time it's the forwards who get it, and believe it or not, it's Keith Wood. Fantastic. Keith Wood, can he score again? His second try of the match, and it really came out of nothing. Keith Wood, a hat-trick of tries, and you will not be able to wipe the smile off his face for a fortnight. Elwood,
look who's on the run.
Over the top. Can he do it? Yes, he can. Oh, my goodness. Lansdowne Road. It's liftoff. Keith Wood has scored four tries, and I don't believe it.
You're just saying, bring back 5% of aggression and put it back into the old brain power, and we win. That's what we're looking at. We're going to outthink them, outfox them, outrun them, outscrummage them, outline them, outkick them if we have to.
Well, again, the All Blacks losing out on their own line out. Here's Keith Wood showing some versatility. Now let's have a look at this. Oh, how's that? How many hookers around the world of international rugby can do that?
Well, commonly referred to by a lot of journalists as the world's number one hooker.
He's a dynamic player. He does everything. He kicks, he catches, he runs, he beats players. There were two bald players on the pitch today, and he won the battle of the baldies. There was no doubt about that, I think.
Well, let's see. There it is on the field.
He's given the try. He's shouting, let the ball go. And in fact, it's Keith Wood himself who has scored. And that'll be one of the most popular tries ever scored. Not only that, it's his 10th try in his 33rd international.
Keith Wood. He possesses all the skills. He can score tries. He can kick the ball. He can lead by example. What a great ornament of the game he's been.
It's 8:41 this morning, and 8:40, just turning 8:42. Michael Collins says, happy birthday, Woody, all the way from Germany, from a fellow East Clare man. Tender Chicken says, show us a video of Woods kicking. There's loads of those I think you should be able to find on the internet. Some of them are absolutely sensational, and some of them are kind of duck hooks. Des Kirby says, happy birthday, Woody. If we had Woody in today's team, we'd be some team, says Kevin Callahan. I think it's interesting that he's been in touch with the hookers coming through. That there's just been contact between them. Because I would say that probably for the first time since Keith Wood, we have someone who has the same style and physical prowess and who might be able to get there. Now, I don't know, if you should look back at the video of even the Argentina game that we lose in that World Cup. He's unbelievable. The speed he's running at. It's unbelievable. Like, it would be, if you could add him into this team right now, there's no doubt that he'd be in addition to it. Like one of our all-time great players, obviously. But it wasn't just it was the explosiveness. And ultimately that cost him, I think, in terms of injuries, you know. Mm. Being able to be so explosive, but also having to put your body on the line the way that in that position particularly you have to do. And then what you're asked to do as a ball carrier too. So
we kind of like to rush for the phrase world class quite a bit around players, but with Keith Wood, it's absolutely genuine. And like, I mean, if we're considering how many players were actually world class in their position, not every position would be ticked off.
No, there's a handful.
Yeah,
in Irish rugby history, there's a handful who you would say at this particular moment in time, are you picking him in a world team? Yes, you are.
Yeah,
and that he's one of them. Aina Carroll says, "Happy 50th, Woody, best hooker of all time, a true legend." And Patchy Amak says, "My grandfather played with Gordon, Keith's dad, in the great 50s team. His name was Brendan Morgan." So I just want to say big up to Richie McCormack. It had all of the fingerprints of Richie's best work there, with the perfect theme tune and brilliant clips picked. So you can all at Richie McCormack, and we'll add him in our tweet later on when we're publishing that on Twitter if you missed it. So top quality work from Richie as well. OTB AM brought to you by Gillette. Good morning. Start with Gillette. Put your best face forward with their new and improved razors. There's going to be a full Brian O'Driscoll preview of the Six Nations that Owen is recording today. That'll be available exclusively on the OTB Sports app a little bit later, and you'll hear it on the radio tomorrow night as well. But if you haven't had enough Six Nations, then don't worry. There's plenty coming your way over the next few days.